Hey there, Internet! My name is Jack Packard, and I cannot die unless you take my head, and with it, my power, here for The Escapist.
Hello, I'm Nick Landro, the editor-in-chief of The Escapist, currently living my life in a virtual reality simulation instead of real world.
How's that going for you?
It's kind of dark in here. I forgot to turn it on.
This week for the Escapist show, we're going to talk about some games like Metroid and some other games like Smash Brothers, because this is a Nintendo-heavy Escapist show. I'm going to counterbalance that. I'm going to give some initial impressions of the PlayStation 5 and Demon's Souls. And then over in the topics, we're talking about the Oculus. It's new, right? Is that what we're talking about? I forgot already.
Oculus Quest 2. Yeah, we didn't even come up with a topic for this episode.
Like, literally, you were just wearing it as part of the bit. And I forgot. And then over in the topics, we'll talk Oculus Quest 2 and Dad of Boy coming to PC.
That was just decided right now.
Just decided right now because I think it's interesting. Hello and welcome. This is the Escapist Show. We are not prepared. Da-dun-dun. All right. Before we delve into Nintendo madness, anyone who watches a stream know that a couple weeks ago, I got myself a PlayStation 5. I found one in the wild. I went to a store and everything. I did not go to a scalper. I haven't got a ton of playtime into it yet, just because, you know, other stuff has come up. A lot more editing has come up with Adventure Is Nigh. Oh ho, we'll go watch it. It's super fun. But here's what I can tell you about the PlayStation 5. It is ugly as hell and way bigger than you expect it to
yes.
be. It's giant. It is stupid big. I hate it. I hate looking at it.
Neither of the consoles this generation are very appealing looking because the Xbox is just a giant box.
Oh, I would rather have that. Give me the monolith.
I'd honestly, like the PS5, when you put it in a TV stand, it looks kind of nice compared to the Xbox. It's literally just a black box.
Oh, I want that. I love simple, brutalist design. This thing, though, I'm pointing at it. You guys can't see it. I hate it. I hate it. I hate looking at it. It's so ugly. And I hate it. And it's just sitting on my, you know, like my desk. You know, I got my little Switch dock there. I got a little power outlet. I got a little Raspberry Pi that I use as a server for Foundry for my D&D games. So like I have nice simple setup. And then amongst all these tiny little things is this giant douchebag with his collar popped. Hey, it's me, PlayStation 5. I hate it. I just hate it so much. I hate looking at it. Also, the disc drive is ridiculously loud.
Yeah, if you wait till you play like a Blu-ray movie in there. Yeah, it literally sounds like a, I mean, I don't know what it is with PlayStation, but everything they put out sounds like a jet engine.
Fuck, every time I start it up, you know, once the game is playing, it's quiet.
Yeah.
It's super quiet. But the disc drive itself, I feel like I can't keep it on my desk there. It's awful.
Yep.
But obviously, it's just a piece of hardware, right?
Yep.
Like, it's ugly. I can always put it under my desk, which I plan on doing. The game itself, Demon's Souls, has been really fun to dig into. I'm not terribly far. I'm only in like the third world. I'm finding it rather easy.
Yeah, it's not too difficult.
And it's a lot of fun to explore. The one thing I know, the thing that you warned me about was the sound design. I chose the magic character. So you start with like the little magic wand. And every time I fire my magic missile, It feels like my cranium is exploding. It's just
yep. Yep. Yeah, that game has incredible sound design.
It's almost too much.
Yeah. Are you playing with headphones or?
No, it comes from the controller, and I got a little like surround sound bar, and so it's just like it's ridiculous.
Yeah, I turned the sounds off on the controller. I hate that noise.
Yes. Yeah, it's loud and ridiculous, but gorgeous looking, and I am going to be incredibly spoiled with how fast you can get into the game. Like, just button, you're playing. Ooh, baby, that solid state drive. Gotta love it.
Yep. And you, so you haven't used a sword yet or anything?
Well, yeah, I have a rip here.
That feels great to play on the controller too, right? Like you can literally feel the stabbing with this.
Yes. Yeah, no, the controller feels great. The rumble feels great. Like thrusting my rip here into an enemy, like you can feel the guts rush past it. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful experience. I wish I had more time to play it. Maybe one day.
Make time.
So that's before we get too Nintendo heavy. That's my little PlayStation 5 quick thoughts. My quick thoughts.
Speaking of games that we don't have time to play that we're playing anyway, because my backlog keeps growing by the day. I think I've started like 10 different games. Like I'm on, you know, I still have Disco Elysium to finish at some point in my life. Maybe before I die. I don't know. I'm still very slowly working through Tales of Arise. I kind of started up Kena Bridge of Spirits with my girlfriend. Then I've been playing Metroid Dread. So my gaming shame is I've never played a Metroid game, even though I've played plenty of Metroidvanias.
Wait, you've never played any of the Metroid games?
Nope.
Really?
Yep.
That's shocking. They're staples of the gaming lexicon. Like, literally, there is a genre named after it.
Well, my gaming lexicon was very piss poor back before I became a games media person. But I am playing Metroid Dread now, and I am quite liking it. The main thing I'm running into that I think maybe the design hasn't aged as well as, like, its contemporaries, is I'm getting lost, like, every 5 minutes, and it's really annoying.
Okay.
And part of that's, like, the opening areas, like, a lot of the level design kind of looks the same as, like, this industrial complex, and you've probably seen it in trailers, like, the white sci-fi lab kind of looking thing, and then on the backdrops, and the game doesn't, like, hold your hand, like a lot of current Metroidvanias do, I think. Like, Ori definitely, like, you get your opening tutorial and you go through and you kind of learn the nooks and crannies of the game as you go in, like, a certain pace. And Metroid is just, like, throw you in, you figure out where you gotta go kind of thing.
Yes!
I do like that. I just think...
Yes, I think queen!
God, I hate that. I think the level design partially doesn't do a great job, like, leading you in the right direction sometimes. Where, like, once you complete an objective, like, you get to the dread part, which is where you're getting hunted by the EMIs or whatever they're called. And once you kind of, like, do that, you're kind of, like, left to, like, where do I go now? And then there's backtracking and then, like, weird, like, walls that you can shoot that are very clear, but then it doesn't make clear that you can shoot the rest of the wall to block it out. So I spent, like, an hour trying to figure out where the hell I had to go and finally gave up and looked at a walkthrough and was like, oh, I was in the right place the whole time.
You mean it's a game that makes you explore? Weird.
I think there's a difference between exploring and just shooting the wall until it breaks in random spots that you can hopefully find it, which is funny enough something Jesse was complaining about the original Metroid and behind schedule, because even in Dread, like there's certain spots that are very clear you're gonna break them. Like there's a certain cube that you can shoot that's obvious, but like there's in the part that I'm talking about too, and you'll get there. I bet you anything you'll get lost at this part too.
Sure.
There's a block you can shoot and then above it just looks like a normal wall. And then there's other parts where, like, there's little, like, exploding, like, alien bits that you can shoot that open up areas, which is clear enough.
This is my copy of Metroid Dread. To give you an idea of how much time I have, I purchased this over a week ago. And it's still in the plastic. It's sitting here on my desk, like, literally mocking me. Like, play me. Don't you want to play me? I do. I very much want to play this game. As I am a huge Metroid fan.
Yeah.
So I'm really, really looking forward to Dread, but
it plays really well. Like it's really I'm having a really good time with it, and it's fun. The world is interesting enough, and like I just finished the first boss fight a couple nights ago, and that was fun and had some unique puzzle elements to it. So I'm definitely looking forward to continuing my time with it. Just I may be that guy that goes on YouTube and looks at like maps to make sure I know where I'm going when I get lost after spending an hour in like one area.
And that's fair. Like, you know, we have the community now. We can look that up. Absolutely.
Yep. I don't have a problem doing that, even though I feel like I might be missing out on some stuff. But only when I absolutely need it will I use the guide.
No, and I unfortunately haven't had a ton of time to play Metroid. Mostly, you know, obviously a lot of regular work to do. And then any Switch time I have, my children have rediscovered Super Smash Brothers. And so we've been playing Super Smash Brothers hardcore for forever, and it's been amazing. You know, Sora just unlocked the last character, the last DLC character. So now we have the full roster to play with, and just super smashing it up with the kids, and it's been phenomenal. Though I am, I'm officially, like, they are starting to win at Super Smash Brothers, which, as a lifelong Super Smash Brothers player, that hurts a little bit, but I feel like, you know, eventually your kids have to kill you, you know, because that's how they become the dominant species.
Well, they're only going to get better. You better start practicing against KC.
I know. I need KC to teach me all the dirty tricks. But no, like, I've even been teaching them, like, how to, like, you know, dodge shift. And we've been playing, you know, no items, no level effects, you know, just Battlefield, no items.
The MLG.
And just, like, yeah, the super pro. And they are still winning because they have time to keep, like, they're playing right now. They are playing Super Smash Bros. Right now while I record this. I can hear it in the background.
And I miss going on, like, big binge sessions with that game, because I stopped playing it, like, in high school and then college. It was huge in college, so every time we had a social event for the fraternity or whatever, bring up, like, the projector and get it loaded up. And
it's great times. Like, I have really mixed feelings about Super Smash Bros. It's a game I love. It's a game that I'm at that awful level that I think a lot of people are at, where it's like, I am significantly better than all of my friends.
Yep.
But not quite good enough to go pro. And so I wasn't allowed to play with my friends a lot because they knew I would win.
I think KC's ears just perked up somewhere. He heard somebody's eyes said they're almost pro at Smash. He's like, prove it.
Not almost. No, not good enough. Definitely not good enough for pro, but way too good for my friends. And so, like, luckily, the later Smash Brothers games came with self-balancing tools, where if you did have that one friend that was good, you could start them at a higher percentage. You could adjust what items spawned. I think they did a really good job of making that game really customizable to every group. Oh, well, one of my favorite games.
I'm going through that usurping, like you are with your kids, of beating you at Smash with my girlfriend, because I'm currently on a losing streak in pool.
Uh-oh.
I'm not happy about it.
Uh-oh.
Don't teach them the skills that they need, Jack. Teach them only what they think they need.
Gotta keep a couple tricks up your sleeve so you can still win.
Yep.
Absolutely not.
Because I fucked up in teaching her how to bank shots, and now she's really good.
The time gets the better of all of us, Nick. That's okay.
Just make sure they never learn how to use a C-stick.
Right. All right, so now we're in the topics before we get to Oculus talk. Let's do a little news. This is, like, fresh news. This is only a day or so old. Is Dad of Boy has a Steam page. Dad of Boy God of War 4 is coming to PC. Much rejoicing was had amongst the masses.
Except for Bloodborne, that's still not coming to PC.
Come
on! God of War coming to PC. You got Uncharted coming to PC. We can't get Bloodborne.
I just finished Bloodborne. I don't need to play it again for a while, but if it came to PC, I would absolutely play it again.
Yeah, that unlocked frame rate.
Pump up those graphics.
Yes, please.
Oh, dang.
I would play it again.
But, you know, it's another avenue in which people who didn't have a PS4 now get a chance to play what is overall, I think, a very good game. It's a game that I have very mixed feelings about, but a very good game overall. And I think that's the important part, is like, hey, let's let more people play these phenomenal games.
Yep, I'm really excited to see Sony's exclusives coming to PC finally. Like, I mean, it's just free sales for them, really. Like, right. It's not like there's no reason not to bring it. Like, this platform war bullshit, like, nah, make the dough so we can make better, more and better games.
Absolutely.
Like, and it's not like, and that they have a porting studio for this stuff now, so now they have no excuse. And obviously it's in their plans to bring all this stuff over to PC, so I think it's only a matter of time. I think I agree with, like, the analysts that, like, they're still not going to release, like, day one, like Xbox is doing, but I think a year after.
Oh no, not even a year after. This,
so?
By the way, this is incredibly savvy of them. They're uploading the hits to PC right before their sequels hit PS5, yeah. Right? Yeah. like Horizon Zero Dawn, it's on PC. Do you love that game?
They get people to buy a PS5 so they don't have to wait 2 years to play it.
Exactly. That's exactly what the thought is.
Except like, you can't buy a PS5.
Play God of War 4 now. Do you love it? Oh, well, guess what? There's a new one if you get a PS5. No, and then we're going to see a super long exclusivity period to just entice people to buy the hardware, which I think it's a smart plan. I'd love to see a Bloodborne, but we're not going to see a Bloodborne hit PC until Bloodborne 2 is in development, which it's not. So,
if you say so. I think the bigger news is that the Uncharted trailer is dropping on Thursday for the Uncharted movie, and part of the footage leaked today. It looks kind of goofy.
Okay, I'm going to say something incredibly controversial.
Uh-oh.
It would be so hard for them to fuck up an Uncharted movie.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically Indiana Jones, but more explosive.
Right.
That's it.
It's like...
I still can't see Tom Holland as Nathan Drake, but so be it.
Like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if he's the Nathan Drake you know, if he's a Nathan Drake. That's all that matters. Like, they need to make a silly... They need to make an action-adventure movie. Like Nicolas Cage did this with National Treasure on a shoestring budget. If they fuck this up, someone needs to stop making movies. This is so simple. I can't wait. I can't wait to see if they mess it up.
Yeah, well, I mean, Yatsier like already said it. Like Uncharted is basically a live action movie as it is as a game.
Yeah.
So yeah, I don't think they'll fuck it up. I guess it's a matter of just like, if people can get invested in, like, if the action's too ridiculous, maybe. I mean, because, like, the clip that was shown was, like, the scene from Uncharted 3 where he's hanging out of the back of a plane.
None of that matters. We have big action-y movies now. People like big action-y movies. I want big action-y set pieces.
Mission Impossible Uncharted, basically.
Exactly. Exactly. But I don't think, like, you know, part of the glory of the Mission Impossible movies is we always think Tom Cruise is going to die because he does his own stunts. Tom Holland's not doing his own stunts, and that's fine. But just give me a big dumb action movie and I'll be happy.
Cool. Yeah, so Oculus Quest 2, as people that have watched the show before know, I quite enjoy VR stuff. Unfortunately, I've had very little reason to enjoy VR stuff since Half-Life Alyx came out because there has been no big game. And yes, we got like the Index for free, but like I'm sad that I haven't had a reason to use it because Half-Life Alyx blew me away. And then like the Index is just like, hey, Valve, are you going to fund some new VR games that are really fucking impressive? Because I haven't seen them. Why aren't you doing it? You sold this big piece of hardware.
It's almost like VR is a niche within a niche within a niche.
It definitely is. But anyway, so... Anyway, I've been keeping an eye on like the Oculus platform. I used to have an Oculus Rift, and I sold that one off to a friend. But the Quest 2 is one that I hadn't really paid too much attention to. And then obviously, you guys have seen that we did a sponsored campaign with them this past week on Resident Evil 4 VR using the Oculus Quest 2. So I've had some more time to spend with it. I purchased some games on my own to try to see kind of the differences. Mm-hmm. So to give you a really, really brief rundown of the Oculus Quest 2, it's a completely wireless Oculus headset, a VR headset. You don't need a computer to use it. You can run games directly off the headset. And I'm actually mildly, I'm really impressed with it. It's nice to not have any cables for it. And like, so like some of the games I already have on Index, like Beat Saber, I was playing on there and it plays great. No problem with it. There's also, I was playing Pistol Whip, which you and I streamed together.
Oh, sure.
Works great on there. Mm-hmm. The other game I was playing is obviously Resident Evil 4 VR, and I've never played Resident Evil 4, so that's been kind of a neat experience playing that game in VR for the first time, and it's really frantic. Like the section from Resident Evil Village, when you're in the opening segment and getting attacked by everything, and basically we talked about how that's like the opening segment of RE4 almost verbatim. Playing that VR was intense as shit. Like having to run around, reload your gun, shoot, keep going, stab something. It's been really fun. So I'm actually excited to play more of it now that we streamed an hour of it this week for the sponsored stream. But it also, like, you would think like maybe because you don't have sensors or anything, like the tracking is maybe not as good. No, it's been great. Like I couldn't tell you the difference between tracking with the Index and this. Like I haven't had any issues with it. There's actually a cool feature. So like if you're putting it on, when you put it on and you're trying to find your controllers, it actually gives you like this grayed out screen so that you can actually see what's around you in like a virtual space.
Sure,
it's,
sure.
It's really fucking weird. It's like literally being in the Matrix. But because like it'll, the headset will sense that like objects are in your play area. And so like it'll tell you, get your chair out of there, asshole.
Oh, yeah.
But that's neat. Yeah, it's, at, you know, the Quest 2 is only $300. And I got to say, like, obviously, like, if you don't have it, you can connect it to your PC and play your Rift games and get like, you know, full graphics on it like you would a normal or a headset. But like I'm playing like The Climb 2 in it. And I really like, it's a sequel to The Climb by Crytek.
What?
Yeah. It still looks really good. Like it's definitely downgraded visually than like what you would get if I was powering it through my PC. But I mean, for anybody that's like a VR enthusiast, I suppose, that wants to try it, like this will be a great headset to start with, I think. If before you shell out $1,000 for Index and get like the real, really good VR stuff, because like you can't play Alex on this mobile. I think if you connect it to the PC, you can. It's all sorts of weird. Like VR has all these weird. Like I can't play Half-Life Alex on my Quest because it's exclusive to the Index on Steam and Vive. Or you know, you can't play Oculus Quest exclusives on my Index, which is annoying.
We just talked about that with PlayStation. You gotta have your hardware exclusives, yep. Of course.
But it just, I don't know, it's crazy to me. Like they expect you to buy a $300 headset, a $1,000 headset to play all these different games. Like, oh, come on, let's unify these VR platforms, please. And obviously, as a note, you do have to have a Facebook account to use this. So if you don't want to support Facebook, then you don't need that. But I have a Facebook account still. I haven't really had
a lot of people do.
Yep, I haven't really had any problems with it. It's not like you can control the information it takes from you. Like you don't have to share anything with your friends or family what you're playing. So if you want to watch your VR porn, you know, you can hide that. But
are you reviewing VR porn now?
Nope. I did get asked to check it out at E3 2017, though.
Really?
Yeah, I like walked in and the first booth I passed was for like VR porn. And like, you want to come check this out? I was like, in public space? No.
No.
That's weird. Yeah. Why would you ask me to do that?
That's private browsing time, all right?
And now you can take it anywhere. Don't do it. Just go out in the parking lot and put your headset on.
No, not in the parking lot. Private browsing.
It's private on your face. that's a pun I did not intend.
Oh no! Nice. You just had, that's a new slogan for the like the VR porn industry, by the way. It's private on your face. You did it, Nick. I don't know if you should be proud of that or not.
No, I'm not. I'm not. It's time to end this before I make it worse.
All right. Well, that was it. That VR section sure took some twists and turns.
Yeah, I'm gaining too much from Yahtzee.
Yes, Yahtzee's a bad influence on you.
Walk it back. Walk it back. Play beat. Damn it! I don't even want to say play Beat Saber on it anymore.
Oh, you spent too long beating your saber. Now we got to end it. All right, well, great. That was all of our talks for today. What an exciting episode of The Escapist Show. Once again, I've been Jack Packard, a semi-professional video game enjoyer here for The Escapist.
And I'm Nick Landry, the editor-in-chief of The Escapist. I'm going back to my happy place.
We know what you're watching in there. We know what you're watching. Don't know.
Halo lore.
Halo porn?
Halo lore.
Are you watching weeb Halo porn? Ew.
You can join me on Sunday after the Escapist Show with Marty, because we're going to be streaming Persona 5. That's what I'm doing. I'm browsing through with my eyes the waifus.
No.